Chris just said everything I was going to say. Here's the schedule. After one student's done, like the next supervisor's comp, introduce your student, and then we can get ready and going. Kevin, we'll switch to the slides. Any questions?
Justin, are you going to do any signals for when they should know? Like,
okay, yeah. So I'll stand up. We got 11 minutes left, and then at 14 minutes, I'll start waving my hand. Let you know you have 1 minute left. So I'll stand up.
11 minutes in, and then 14.
Yeah. Early. All right. So up first is Adam. Oh, and the way we're kind of working from the top of the food chain on down.
Birds are the pinnacle of creation.
First up, Adam Capito, coming from Ohio State, working in the Natural Resource Center, which I told myself now, I've lost track. But he's been working with me on the bird project, and so without any further ado, I'll leave it to Adam.
So I worked with Dr. Marshall on the survivorship of birds in the Lake Erie region.
Sure, that works. Okay. Forward, backwards, laser pointer. Good.
So, Lake Erie and the islands and coastline that comprise it are a very critical habitat for both migrating species of birds and birds that breed in the area. And so this actually stimulates a lot of tourism, as many people come from all over to observe the birds during their migratory paths in the spring. And this generates $26 million annually just from bird watching alone. And so there are multiple organizations and people that are contributing to, you know, preservation of these ecosystems. And so partly what we're trying to figure out is what is the likelihood that a bird survives in a nature preserve versus a human-dominated ecosystem. And these are two nature preserves we actually banded at Sheep, East Point, and Middle Bass Island. And so this is an ongoing research project. So essentially what we're trying to do is capture as many previously banded birds. This is also a recapture, so a bird that was banded previously, and then we catch it again this year. And so we're focusing primarily on two species, the American robin and the red-winged blackbird. They're primarily abundant in the area, so that's why we focused on them. And we're using the past 6 years of data to calculate survivorship given various conditions. So we're looking at a year-to-year comparison, island to island, and then the human-dominated and nature preserve. And a big thing you have to take into consideration is while a bird might survive from one year to the next, that doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be caught. So the recapture probability provides a much better estimate for your overall survivorship rate when you're actually analyzing your data. And so these are our site locations, so our human-dominated systems, North Bass Island, Gibraltar, and Bayview, and then the nature preserves, Middle Bass Island and South Bass Island. And so this is our North Bass Island. It might not look like it, but it is human dominated. That's actually a vineyard. And this is Gibraltar Island. One thing I should point out about this is that there are two nets set up in this picture, but they're really hard to tell because the shade provides a really good cover. So this is kind of the conditions that you want when you're setting up your nets. You want to find good tree cover such that the birds are having a hard time seeing it. And this is Middle Bass Island. Once again, a good amount of sumac cover. And then South Bass Island. This was definitely our most fruitful location in terms of catching birds. And so our methods, we had 9 12-meter nets and 1 6-meter net. And we pretty much set them up around the same locations. We went to each site 4 times, I should mention. 3 times were with just me and Dr. Marshall. And then 1 time for each was with the evolution class. And so we checked every net every so often, and any bird that was in it, we would untangle it, put it in a bag, and then bring it back to the banding station. And so some of the measurements we took were the age, species, sex, fat content, wing length, and weight. And then for recaptures, we would just write down the existing band number that was already on it and then take the same measurements as before, and this is a bird being weighed. So On the left, you'll see a picture of a collapsed mist net, and then on the right is the fully expanded mist net, and they are 2.5 meters tall when they're fully expanded. And this is on South Mass Island. So first species we're looking at, the blackbirds, there's a very obvious difference in between the male and the female. These are after second year birds, so their red patch is both fully developed. And here's the American robin, also a very abundant species you might have seen around the island. And we did catch a lot of other birds, though. So here's a house finch and a flicker woodpecker, and then a downy woodpecker and a male northern cardinal, a yellow warbler and a house wren, two different species of orioles, and then a phoebe and a nuthatch, and then male and female American goldfinch. When you look at the data from this year, we had 2,100 captures from previous years, some dating back to as early as 2010, so 6-year bird, that's pretty impressive. And 212 was the amount of birds that were unbanded that we caught, and that comprised 24 different species. Red-winged blackbirds and tree swallows actually comprised half of these individuals. So in total, over the 6 years, we've caught 2,100 birds, a little bit more than that. So when you look at the diversity over the past 6 years, you'll notice that the blackbirds and the robins comprise more than half of all species. But when you look at this year, well, the first thing you'll notice is that the overall diversity decreased, but the blackbirds and the tree swallows actually comprise half the species. The robin was actually fourth on the list. And so when we compiled the 6 years of data, we had over 200 robins and 800 blackbirds from the past 6 years. And we used two main models to represent the species. So we used an island-to-island and year-to-year comparison and a human-dominated versus nature preserve and year-to-year model. So basically what these are saying is, okay, we're recognizing that both the recapture rate and the survivorship rate will change given these two conditions. And so we used the program MARC to model the data in different ways. We're kind of just comparing different models, different ways of representing the data that'll give us a good estimate of, you know, what we're trying to find out. And so the AIC is what allows us to do that. So it basically determines what's the simplest and most accurate model given the data. So when you have more parameters describing your data, it might explain it better, but it also makes it more complex, which isn't necessarily a good thing. And so what it does is it looks for what's most simple, the most, you know, descriptive way of showing what your data means. And so we use two variables, the survivorship rate, which is V, and the recapture rate, which is P, and then we put those in a function. And when you look at this table, mainly what you want to focus on is the delta AIC. So typically a delta AIC of 2 or less is basically what it means is a good model to use. And so when you look at the red-winged blackbird model. This is saying that the survivorship rate is changing from year to year, and the recapture rate is changing from year to year and island to island. So that's one way of modeling the data. And when you look at the graph, you'll notice a decent amount of error between the majority of the bars, but you look at the last data point, and you'll notice that it provided a pretty good estimate, actually, of survivorship, around 0.6, which is generally what the survivorship rate of pasture and species tends to be. Another model you'll look at is the time-to-time difference. So this is looking primarily at the differences between years of survivorship and recapture rate together. And once again, a lot of error in the first 4 years, but the last year to this year provided, once again, a pretty good estimate of survivorship around 0.55. And then this year, this is a representation of the island-to-island differences. And what's really interesting about this graph is that they all kind of tend to fall around the same survivorship rate, the Southwest Island being the most accurate of the four that were actually on the graph. But what the long-term data set will allow us to do is kind of look at the change in between all four, or hopefully five, because we weren't catching many on the Bayview office location. But it's an interesting trend that we're seeing. They're kind of all leveling out. And so with our ecosystem model, we really weren't able to determine much that was useful given the different models. And so we had to use, we had to move on to the American robin and look at two main models for that. So we had the island-to-island difference. And this is basically telling us there was a lot of error in between the majority of the islands except for South Bass once again. South Bass is definitely showing that it was a more likely location to provide a good estimate. We're just catching more birds, basically. And then when you look at the time-to-time difference and the year-to-year difference, you're realizing that, once again, this past year provided a pretty good estimate in terms of survivorship. The 2011 to 2012 and 2014-2015, it says one, but that's not reliable at all. The way that MARC works, sometimes that levels out like that, so those aren't reliable sources. But for our ecosystem model, we actually had a pretty decent estimate as to what the survivorship rate is like for a human-dominated and preserved comparison. So what we found is basically the American robin had a better survivorship rate in a human-dominated ecosystem in comparison with the nature preserve, which might surprise some of you. And it kind of surprised me at first, but when you actually ask what the data means and what it's looking at, you have to realize that there's a lot of variation in between the ecosystems, resource availability, and mainly the habitat. That's the main sort of reasoning behind why these were why these show different results. So when you take an island like Gibraltar, for example, there's a lot more robins on it than, say, South Bass Island. That's a nature preserve. And so when you look at the habitat that they prefer this sort of habitat, a forested ecosystem. But on South Bass, it's more of like a really successional shrub type forest. And so it's not necessarily the preserve that's changing it. It's more just the actual habitat. And like I said, the variation in between the habitats. So on the left is a picture of North Bass Island from a few years ago, and on the right is from this previous year. And so what you'll notice is that there's a lot less cover as far as the vines that are growing on the right there. And that influences the amount of birds that like to hop across the cover. And so that definitely influenced our results this year in that we weren't really catching many on North Bass. And so it's important to recognize that this is a long-term data set. And so some years you're not going to get the best data, but it's important that you have a complete continuous set of data. And this is actually the first year that there have been survivorship estimates that are usable. While only a handful of the models actually provided a good survivorship estimate, the accumulation of data over the years is proving to be worth something. And so in order to get a better estimate of survivorship, we just need more data. So that's why we're continuing to do this project. And a year of poor data basically just means we're not catching as many birds as a year of good data. So this year we caught a little over 200, but in past years they caught over 400. So it really just depends. One thing I should mention, there was no observed movement in recaptured birds between islands. So basically a bird that was caught on an island and banded has a 100% chance of being caught in that same place the next year if it is caught. And so protecting a population requires knowledge of what's going on in the ecosystem. So you don't just want to know what's happening, but why it's occurring. Why am I seeing these variations in between a human-dominated and a preserve? You have to look at the variations in habitat and the resource availability, things like that. So it's not always just a clear-cut picture when you look at the graph. And so what this kind of implies for management purposes is that when you're trying to apply it to a management setting, you have to know when your data is actually usable. So going back to the human-dominated system, that's not, it's not saying that a nature preserve isn't good for the bird necessarily. It's just saying that the habitat is what affects it. So it's not saying that you should change, what you're doing to a nature preserve, because while the robins might not be surviving there better, it's just because they're not living there in general. A lot of other birds are, and they're flourishing there. So it really just depends on a lot of other variables. And so for, I'd like to thank Dr. Marshall, the evolution class, for coming out and banding on certain days. Anyone who previously contributed to this data set, Tom Bartlett, he is the one that Dr. Marshall bands under, and still not faculty and staff, the captains, and IOC grant. You mean based on, like, the habitat that it prefers?
Mm-hmm.
No, we didn't really specifically look at what kind of habitat the bird prefers. It was more just a general survivorship and recapture estimate. We only had so much to work with. And, you know, if you could do that, that would be something that would be, you know, worth looking into because, like I said, that just comparing a human-dominated and a preserve doesn't necessarily mean that much in terms of what the bird is actually preferring. So...
So that suggests that what you'd really like to do in a follow-up is find similar habitat in a preserve and in a human-dominated area.
You want to minimize the differences between the two because, well, in that case, then the human-dominated and the preserve are essentially the same. The only thing that's differing is the actual human presence. So that would be interesting to see. You know, if you eliminate the variation in habitat, what is actually, you know, the effect of having humans in the area? So, yeah.
Can you mention the change at Northback also? I think you went on Southback. Do you think, I know you mentioned that you had a higher scale limit at Northback. Do you think that also affects the rate of that
scale? Yeah, it could have. So, scale leg disease is it's a certain mite that burrows in the legs of primarily blackbirds, and we didn't see a whole lot of scaly leg throughout, but it was present, and so that would be really something you'd have to look at, you know, more in detail, because if we're only catching, you know, just a few birds that have scaly leg, it might not be saying much. However, it might actually be influencing their survivorship as a whole, so that's why we might just see less birds there in general.
Adam, great presentation, thanks. So the last slide, I think you had mentioned that there was no, when you had a recapture, it was recaptured on the same island.
Mm-hmm.
Is that unusual given the two species that you were tracking, or is that something that was pretty expected?
I'd say it was pretty expected. So, I mean, I'm pretty new to, like, banding in general and just learning about birds. But when you think about it, we're looking only at adult birds, and so... If a bird is coming back to the same place two times in a row and it migrates, it's probably going to come back to the original place. So if we're looking at, like, a hatchier bird, there's not as good of a chance it's going to come back to the same location. And so generally it does make sense that it's in the same spot. It is interesting, though, because the islands are pretty close. But.
They died over the weekend. He didn't flip out or freak out, and we took it in stride. So anyway, Kevin will explain his project to you.
Kevin, is there a presenter view?
Presenter view?
No.
All
right. I'm going to wing it. All right. So thanks for the introduction, Chris. My name is Kevin Fisher, and my REU that I've been working on this summer is... the determination of a thermal coefficient for largemouth bass and a I-button thermal logger. The picture on the bottom right is the eye button attached to a acoustic telemetry device, as well as the large mouth pass.
He wasn't in the IT club in high school, so he's learning on the fly here. Okay. And so
all right, so temperature is extremely important to ectotherms because it influences their, they have specific thermal tolerance ranges for which they can survive. It also plays a role in their metabolic rate, following a rule of something called Q10, which is a relationship of the change of 10 degrees Celsius relates to a increase in an enzymatic rate of 2.5 times. This relationship influences the consumption and growth of fish. As you can see here, as the temperature increases, the metabolic rate of the fish increases fairly significantly. It also is important for a cue for gametogenesis. It also has influences on the dissolved oxygen content in the water. Acoustic telemetry is an important method for investigating fish migrations and habitat usage. It's a method of putting acoustic receivers out in the lake, and then you tag fish, and as the fish get within a certain receiving range, it pings the receiver and gives a time and location that's able to track fish movements. The Great Lakes Acoustic Telemetry Observation System was founded by the Great Lakes Fish Commission, and monitors fish stocks across large geographic scales in the Great Lakes. ODNR currently has 1,000 fish tagged as part of this program, with acoustic telemetry devices attached with eye-button thermal loggers. The two main species that they have tagged in Lake Erie, Maumee, and Detroit rivers are walleye and
Lake trout.
Newton's law of cooling is the law that I use to, or has been generally found to be the best way to study temperature changes in for fish, and it generally states that the rate of cooling is related to the difference in temperature of a body and the surrounding ambient temperature. What I'm actually calculating is the thermal rate coefficient, which is this value here. All of the other variables were determined experimentally. From that, calculating that value, we were able to use first-order kinetics for thermodynamics to and applying radioactive decay theory in order to get a value that's more easily to interpret, and that's T halftime. And it's the time required for a fish body temperature to change by half the difference between initial and final temperatures. As you can see, after approximately 5 T half times, the fish body temperature should be approximately equilibrated to ambient temperature. So for the first experiment that I conducted, we looked at just the thermal coefficient of the eye button and transmitter. Again, this is what the transmitter looks like, and this is the eye button at the end. They were placed inside this basket and submerged into the tanks. Apparently, my formatting is a little messed up. So for the methods for the first experiment, all of the eye buttons that were used to record data throughout the experiment were programmed to record in 2-minute intervals. They were then attached to the acoustic telemetry devices and waterproofed with tool dip. The water temperatures for each of the tanks that we used were manually recorded with a YSI probe as well as continuously with auto temperature loggers in each tank. And for the first eye button experiment, the ambient temperatures and chill temperatures were 24.5 degrees Celsius and 16.3 degrees Celsius. And they were transferred back and forth in 1 hour intervals so that we had three cooling trials and three heating trials. And I will give you a better picture of that in a second. The second experiment that we conducted was the determination of the thermal rate coefficient for largemouth bass. Largemouth bass were collected from East Harbor in the highlighted area here using electrofishing in the afternoon on July 6, 2016. And for reference, here's Stone Lab, so just south a little bit. So the fish in there were collected, they were acclimated for about a half a day. And then we implanted them with the eye button thermal loggers. And the first step is to anesthetize the fish. So the fish are placed into this cooler here, and which is, you know, there's electrodes that are attached to this machine here, which is a portable electroanesthesia system. And these are the settings that we used. And this successfully anesthetized the fish so that we could perform the surgical implantation. The surgical board that we used, the fish were removed from the tank where they were anesthetized up onto the top of the surgical board, which had water in the bottom and a tube that continuously pumped water over the gills during the surgery. This is a picture of the actual surgery in process or in progress. And once they were on the surgical board, a small incision was made on the ventral side of the fish, and the eye button was inserted into the body cavity. Then 2 to 3 sutures or dissolvable sutures were used to close the wound or the incision, and the surgeries generally took about 90 seconds to or a minute and a half to 2.5 minutes long to complete. So this is the experimental system that I used. This first tank down here was a single tank flow through system that pulled water straight from Lake Erie into it, and that was our ambient experimental chamber. The two tanks at the back were set up under a recirculating system with a chiller that kept the cooling reservoir chilled and was then pumped into the experimental chilled chamber. The chiller was set to 11 degrees Celsius for experiment 1 and 15.5 degrees Celsius for experiment 2. So before we started the experiment, we took all of our largemouth bass and we placed them into a large net in order to restrict movement within the tanks and to allow for easier transfer between the two treatments. Again, the temperatures were recorded for during each transfer, we recorded the temperatures for both of the tanks, and they were transferred every 90 minutes for three heating trials and three cooling trials. The results for the first experiment conducted, we found that in general there was no difference in the T-half time between warming and cooling trials, as well as for the thermal rate coefficient for the eye buttons. So we combined the data to get an average eye button and transmitter thermal rate coefficient. Results for the second experiment were similar in that there was no difference between the warming and cooling trials that were conducted for the T-half time and the rate coefficient. So those, again, were combined down here. The weight range of the fish that were used for the experiment was between 550 and 950 grams. And again, there was 8 fish in the experiment. So this is a graph of the heating curves for each individual fish. And each point represents the point at which the eye button logged a temperature recording. And the variation that is seen between the graphs is
caused by differences in the weight of the fish. They have different thermal rate coefficients, as well as this is the point at which T half times completes, which is where the graph approximately levels out. Investigating or looking more closely at the relationship of weight to the thermal rate coefficient. This is a there's a negative correlation that was found between the thermal rate coefficient and weight. What this means is that larger fish take longer to equilibrate than smaller fish. And the parameters that were found for this regression are similar to values that were found for brook trout in the study, previous study. So the thermal rate of change that was found for the eye buttons does not influence the thermal measurements that were found for the largemouth bass. It's important to know that the thermal rate coefficient for the eye buttons is much quicker than the, or is much higher than the largemouth bass, so that you know that there's no influence from lag time in the insulation, so that the temperatures that you're actually recording are accurate and you do not need to apply a correction function to the data that's retrieved. The current study also looked at what had found similar results to a paper or an experiment that was conducted in 1979 that also looked at largemouth bass for heating trials for a regression of the T half time versus weight. A T half time of 5.4 minutes is what was determined for this experiment, so that means that it's approximately 27 minutes for the fish to reach equilibrium. And this time to reach equilibrium is much smaller than the eye button sample rate of 4 hours, which means that there could be a lot of thermal, or there's a lot of lot less resolution that might be needed to actually fully investigate the thermal preferences or usage of the fish. And then I'd like to acknowledge or thank Dr. Chris Vandergoot, Dr. Jeff Steinhardt, Dr. Richard Krause, OSU Stone Lab, and Ohio Sea Grant. Any questions?
We have time for one or two questions.
Yeah.
So I know you were looking to do this for walleye originally.
Yeah.
But you found that the bass results were very similar to the trout results. And maybe I think you said similar to some other results as well. Do you think that probably these equations would seem pretty reasonable for a walleye as well?
It's very possible. There's some the equations that were found were like the parameters were within like the R values were similar to what was found for other species. There is a difference in the actual thermal rate coefficient between those species, and that also is very dependent on the weight that we found. So in the walleye, I believe they're quite a bit larger than the largemouth bass, so that could have a significant.
If you're thinking, like you showed some equations that included weight in that, so if you account for weight,
well, this is both with this one. Is that what you're
saying? Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah.
These are both largemouth bass.
Oh, those are both.
Yes, it's a previous study that was also conducted with largemouth bass from Stockton, South Carolina. They had a slightly larger range that they explored. It was 80 grams to 290 grams. I believe.
Kevin. So just to understand, so part of this is that with the telemetry device, you can get a location of that fish's movement from mm-hmm. here. And now with the button, what you're trying to do is now get the vertical distribution of that fish. Would this suggest that if 27 minutes to reach equilibrium, you can't get a final scale resolution than 27 minutes? So if a fish goes down to do some kind of foraging and then comes back to the surface and it happens in a shorter time than that, there's a possibility you'll miss that.
So largemouth bass and the sizes that we examine, it's very feasible that you could completely miss a dive through the thermocline to the bottom forage and then come back up. It could have already equilibrated. back to the temperature that it was at prior.
And so the 4 hours you could reference the program for that is because that gives us a full year's worth of data. So if we're concerned about what they're doing, say, in the summer, then we can dial that back a little bit, or for certain some, you know, specified period of time. But we don't want to dial back too much more than half an hour because the efficient spot is not going to give you an accurate reading.
Anybody else? Can I ask one more, Justin? Is that all right? We have time.
Oh, thanks, man. So I was actually surprised by the size of the fish, because I wasn't in on the surgeries, of course. But the size of the fish, if you're just slicing the fish and placing it right underneath the skin, why would that, I mean, I would think the button would adjust at the same rate, given its exposure, at least distance from the water, perhaps. So can you maybe talk about why that
is? Well, what we found is that the buttons actually do equilibrate at the same rate as the fish does, the fish body. So what the first experiment was examining whether or not the eye button could be a limiting factor in the analysis or in the rate of change for the fish. And then the second experiment was, once we determined that that wasn't a limiting factor, actually calculating the rate of change for the fish body.
All right.
Will be a junior at Boston University, and he did an excellent job this summer. That's actually far more around Gobi than I think he could have imagined. Has scored more behavioral trials than I think he cared to, and anyone would. And has done an excellent job with it, and yeah.
Thank you. Okay. Hi. Like Isaac said, my name's Alex, and I study at Boston University. I'm from the Cleveland area of Northeast Ohio, and my supervisor was Dr. Legoski for this project, and I was looking at dominance, aggression, and resource holding potential in the round goby. So I'm sure a lot of us here at Stone Lab are very familiar with the round goby because it is extremely abundant all around Gibraltar Island, but for anyone who's not, the scientific name of the round goby is Neogobius melanostomus, and it's an invasive species here in the Great Lakes. It's actually a native species to the Black and Caspian Seas in Eurasia, and it was brought to the Great Lakes around the 1990s in the ballast water of transoceanic cargo ships. And since it arrived here in the Great Lakes, it spread very quickly, and that's thanks to a couple traits that the round goby has. Two of which are its adaptability and its aggressiveness. In terms of adaptability, the round goby is able to live in a variety of different environments, and it's also able to eat a great amount of different food, including mollusks and fish eggs. And also, it's very aggressive, which allows it to evict native species from their natural habitats, such as log perch and sculpin here in the Great Lakes. And as I mentioned, its broad appetite includes fish eggs, and many of those fish eggs are actually the eggs of native species to the Great Lakes, such as lake trout, lake sturgeon, and smallmouth bass, which only emphasizes their harmful effect on the Great Lakes. One important thing to note about the research I'm doing is that it was a behavioral study, and in terms of round goby research, behavioral studies are sort of rare. In fact, most studies on the round goby have been done from an ecological standpoint, and very few have been done for the behavior. And the reason behavior is important is because behavioral systems are very complex, and research is needed to inform further studies about the round goby, and also really to allow us to predict the ultimate consequence the round goby will have on any freshwater system. And most importantly, in order to control the population of round goby, it's really important to know the basic behavior of the species, and that also goes for conservation efforts of evicted native fish. So at the very beginning of this process, I made a couple predictions based on literature that I had read about the round goby, and the first of which was larger fish would be more dominant and aggressive than smaller round goby. I also predicted that larger size differences between a given group of fish would lead to less ambiguous dominance relationships between the group of fish, and also that larger fish would better be able to acquire a shelter and also maintain territorial hold over that shelter. So going into the actual methods of my experiment, the first problem, or the first bump we ran into was a problem in which we didn't have an actual enough amount of gobies to run any of our trials. So we tried a variety of different ways to get gobies, the first of which was minnow traps. And here I am looking very sad with a minnow trap because it didn't work at all. Next up, we tried catching them by hand with nets. That also didn't work, and I got my behavioral ecology class to help me seine for them. And that, we caught a few, but not enough to run any trials. So in the end, we decided to call out the big guns, and we threw a giant net behind a boat and did what's called trawling, which is just dragging that net on the lake floor of Lake Erie, and that got us a couple hundred gobies, which was enough for us to carry out our research. And we also used goby from the OSU Aquatic Visitor Center, which was also very helpful. So the bulk of my experiment hinged around trials, in which we took three gobies of different sizes and the same gender, and put them in a 10-gallon aquarium. And we filled these aquariums prior with fresh water from Lake Erie right outside. And we also put two shelters in each aquarium that I'll elaborate on in a second. And we also surrounded each aquarium with a black blind in an attempt to reduce the outside stimulus on the fish inside so it didn't affect their behavior. And after that, what we did is after putting the gobies in, we give them a 5-minute habituation period, followed by a 60-minute trial period where we recorded the gobies from above with GoPros so that we could rewatch those videos and assess their behavior later. After these trials were over, we removed the gobies and we took several measurements, two of which were mass and length of the gobies. And then we also took the mass of the reproductive organs of the goby, because research has shown that there's different sexual phenotypes of the goby that may affect their behavior. And we also took the mass of their liver, because in some fish it's shown that there's a positive correlation between cortisol and cortisol, which is a stress hormone, and the liver size of the fish. So here are close-ups of the two shelters that were in the previous slide. We called the one on the left the high-quality shelter and the one on the right a low-quality shelter. And these names were based off correspondence we had with a researcher, Erin McCallum, in McMaster University. And basically, her research shows that gobies prefer the high-quality shelter over the low-quality shelter. So Dr. Legoski and I were really interested in seeing how having a preferred shelter versus an unpreferred shelter would play out in behavioral interactions between the gobies. So after we had all the videos recorded, we had to go through the scoring process. One of the things that this entailed was recording the time each individual goby spent in each individual shelter. Then we also had to count the number of aggressive and submissive acts each goby gave to one another. And counting the amount of aggressive and submissive acts meant we had to understand what aggressive and submissive acts were. And for that, we used a previous study which had created an ethogram for round goby. And an ethogram is basically just a catalog of all the known behaviors of a particular species, in this case, our study species. And through this ethogram, we found out that the most common aggressive behaviors that we would see would be chases, displacements, bites, and rams from one goby to another. and then what we considered a submissive behavior under this ethogram was fleeing of one goby from another. So after we had all these counts of behavior, we had to think of a way to quantify the overall aggressiveness, submissiveness, and dominance of each goby. And to do this, we used two more previous studies, which gave us the idea for the formulas you see up here. And basically, what we did was we created composite scores for each of these three behaviors. For example, the aggression composite was simply the number of aggressive acts given plus the submissive acts received. And the submissive and dominance indices were based off similar formulas, which just gave us an overall idea of each of the fish's behavior. So next up, we made three linear mixed models in the programming language R to determine the significance of our data. And our linear mixed models used several variables, one of which was the predicted rank based on standard length of each fish. And basically what that means is, based on my predictions, we thought that the largest fish would indeed be the most aggressive, most dominant, and least submissive. So we tried to find out through these models if predicted rank was significantly associated with any of the indices that I'd shown in the previous slide. Fixed effects in these models also included individual size, interactions between individuals, and the sex of the group of gobies that we were analyzing. And also, we added a random effect to the model, which was group identity. And as the box plots nicely illustrate, we did actually find a significant association between the predicted rank and each of the behaviors stated previously, which basically means the larger fish acted a lot more aggressive than the other two fish in each tank, a lot less submissive, and overall more dominant than the other two fish. Next up, we tried to find out if there was any correlation between aggression, dominance, and submission, and the time spent in each shelter, be it high quality or low quality. We ran general linear models in this instance, and we were unable to find any significance with our current data. So, we found no significance between there. And so, our key findings from our results basically was that the ultimate takeaway from our study is that larger gobies will tend to be more dominant and aggressive and less submissive than smaller gobies. And there's no true significance between dominance and aggression and shelter usage in the species. So going back to the predictions I made before we started the project, the only prediction that our data truly supports is that larger fish tend to act more dominant and aggressive. And the other two, we have to go into more analysis or experimental processes to support. In terms of the broader context of the research, the results of our study did find agreements with previous research I'd encountered, such as a study that indicated that a 3% size difference is sufficient for a larger goby to fend off a smaller one. And it also overall agrees with the idea that the aggressive behavior of gobies lends itself to the goby's ability to evict native species out of their habitat. Future directions that I think it would be useful to take would be to assess the correlations between behavior, sex, liver and gonad size, and reproductive state, since we did take those measurements. And if I were to repeat this trial, I would maybe use longer trials than just 60 minutes, as it might reveal more about shelter usage by the gobies. And we also have a few more videos to score, and more data is always good. So that'd be something we'd want to do. Before I finish, I'd just like to make a few acknowledgments. The Stone Lab staff was invaluable in the success of this experiment, so I'd like to thank them for helping me out with things such as goby acquisition and transportation, among other things. I'd also like to mention Dr. Seagal Ballshine and Aaron McCallum from McMaster University, who provided us with the high-quality and low-quality shelters, and also gave us some reviewing of our experimental procedures before we started. And also, I'd have to thank my behavioral ecology class for helping me stay. And, of course, Dr. Legoski, thank you so much. This project would be impossible without you. That's it.
Why do you think they weren't used? Was it just time?
I think a big factor was time. There could have been other factors as well, such as the fish hadn't established the dominance hierarchy, which I guess also goes into the time category. And it is possible that the plastic around the tanks might have been interpreted as a shelter if the fish was in between one of the shelters and the side of the tank. But as far as that goes, I'm not too sure. But I'd hope that maybe time would help resolve some of that. Yep.
Do you have any thoughts about whether the goby would be more aggressive to other species compared to other gobies, or do you think it's equal opportunity?
I have read studies that say the gobies do act aggressively towards other species that tend to inhabit the same habitat as them, such as log perch and sculpin. As far as the extent of the aggressiveness compared to its actions towards another goby, I'm not too sure. But I think I might predict that it'd be similar if the fish was smaller than it is, act quite aggressive.
Thank you.
Everyone, a lot of you don't know me either, but you should know Caroline McElwain. She was my RE student working on turbidity and fish, and I wanted to acknowledge that a lot of the day-to-day sort of supervision and running of this project was aided in large part by Chelsea Neiman, my PhD student, while I was off in Africa.
Okay, so I'm Caroline. And my project was looking at the effects of turbidity on emerald shiner vision. Okay. Turbidity is a measure of the level of particles, like sediment or plankton, in a body of water. There's organic turbidity and there's non-organic turbidity. So organic turbidity would be like algae in a body of water, and non-organic turbidity would be something like loose sediment. So turbidity is a natural occurrence, but there are a lot of anthropogenic activities that increase turbidity. Some of the major human influences come from agricultural runoff, urban stormwater runoff, and dredging. The agricultural runoff is mainly from fertilizer, which introduces nitrogen and phosphorus into the water sources, which allows the algae to thrive. And the urban stormwater runoff comes from, like in urban areas, we have a lot of construction going on, which brings up a lot of loose sediment, and then we use a lot of impervious surfaces, like sidewalks and roads. So that will all be washed away straight into the water sources. And you can't really see, but there has been documented species loss and displacement in some lakes due to turbidity. So increased turbidity will cause the loss of a species and vice versa. And right down here, I have just a little scale. So this would be like a clear water source, and then this is it getting murkier and murkier. And this is like sort of like the chocolate milk type of water that you see in some lakes. So turbidity affects light attenuation, which is a decrease in light with depth through absorption and scattering. Absorption is the loss of light through the loss of heat, And scattering is the loss of light by deflection of light rays. So we have the spectrum here, and then the depth is on this axis right here. So this just shows the spectrum of light that you would see as you're descending into a body of water. So you lose both ends of the spectrum, and you kind of get this blue-green light. And then this is what it would look like in freshwater if there was green algae present. So you sort of, the light doesn't penetrate as far, and it shifts the spectrum. So there's less of the blue-green light, and it's more of like a yellow-blue-orange light that's being reflected. And then down here I have one of sediment, but we can't see that right now. So my question, we know that turbidity decreases the light intensity, and we know that algal turbidity changes the color being reflected. So here we have this graph, and it shows the light intensity on the y-axis and the wavelength on the x-axis. So the blue line is in clear water, so we see that the most light gets through that, and this is the wavelength that's getting through. The sediment, there's a decrease in light coming through, penetrating, but the wavelength stays the same. The color reflected is pretty much the same. But then green algae, it's even less, and it shifts the wavelength. So I'm trying to figure out at what turbidity can an individual no longer see, a question mark, and I would predict that they'll be able to see better in sedimentary turbidity than in algal turbidity. So my focal species was the emerald shiner. It's an important freshwater forage fish. It's native to the Great Lakes, including Lake Erie. They are a planktivore fish, and they're also a spooling fish. And they're called emerald shiners because you can see they have this nice emerald color right here. When I say it's an important forage fish, I mean a lot of the commercially important species in the lake eat it. Okay. So they will they'll eat the shiners. So while they're really important, not only ecologically, but they're commercially and recreationally important. And shiners consist of a large part of their diet. They're also very influential in the structure and abundance of the zooplankton community. So here's a little photo of Daphnia, which is what they eat. And then down here I have photos of turbid waters. So this is algal turbidity. This is one of the harmful algal blooms with the pea soup type water that we've been seeing here in the Great Lakes. And then this is sedimentary turbidity. So this is like that chocolate milky water. Kind of gross. So in order to test visual sensitivity, we had this idea. This was used in another paper. And the idea is to have a tank, and then you have a screen with the vertical black and white lines, and it's rotating around. And the fish has this innate optokinetic response, and it will follow the lines. It'll use them as a reference point and follow them. And it's been documented in a lot of species of fish. Zebrafish do it, guppies do it, cichlids do it, and also other taxa, like mice, will do it. So it's fairly widespread. And then here, I have this. It doesn't work in the webinar. I have this photo to show you guys. So this is the optomotor machine that we made, and this is the fish, and he's following the lines around. So what I was doing is I was adding turbidity to the water, and then I was recording the point at which the fish stopped following. All of my shiners were Lake Erie caught shiners. Our goal was 15 fish to be finished by the end of the summer. We were doing 4 total trials per fish. We had 2 sedimentary trials and 2 algal trials. So we were taking the average of the sediment trials and then also the average of the algal trials for our analyses. And we did that because we wanted to reduce the error. And then we were doing about 30 to 60 minute acclimation times. My trials were taking 1 to 2 hours or more if they were really good at seeing. And we were using natural light, To date, we have 9 fish completed. So that's what I've used in my analysis. And then right here, I just have a little picture of the outside of it. So it's actually on a record player. And then I have a paper screen taped onto the record player. And it's spinning at 8 rotations a minute. And then I suspend this tank with fish in it from these ring stands. So that was probably the hardest part of the experiment. We were measuring turbidity in nephelometric turbidity units, which are units, they're often used to measure turbidity, and they're units that are relative to DI water, so deionized water with 0 particles in it. That would be 0 NTU units. And then up here I have a little diagram of how it works. So you have your sample, and then the light beam shines through it, and then all of the scattered light goes to this detector, which then gives us a value of deionized water, or of the turbidity of the water. And down here, you can't see it as well, but this is an 80 NTU sedimentary turbid water, and this is about 40 NTUs of algal turbidity water. And to add turbidity, I made 2 solutions. I made 1 of sediment, and so it's 20 grams of dried Lake Erie mud, and it was mixed with 55 milliliters of lake water. And then I had algal turbidity solution. And I was blending about 1/4 a bag of spinach with 50 milliliters of lake water, and then I would strain it. And we use spinach because it gets the concentration up higher than actual blue-green algae, and it's the same color, so it reflects light the same way. And other studies have used it. So that's how we did that. And we were adding them, we were adding it drop by drop. I was trying to increase the turbidity by about 2 to 3 NTU units each time. And then I was recording it, and then I'd go add the next, and then stop when they stopped following. So here I have a graph of turbidity, the ending point. And then down here, this is sediment, and then this is algae. So we found that the fish in sedimentary turbidity could actually see at higher NTU levels than those in algal turbidity, which supports my prediction. Here's my p-value right here. And to analyze this, we used a paired t-test because it wasn't independent sample. And then we wanted to find out whether the length of the fish, like the size of the fish, had to do with their visual ability. So we used a linear regression, and we plotted the turbidity that they stopped at against down here. This is the standard length of the fish. And because the data was non-normally distributed and there were outliers, we log transformed the data. And we found that it was not significant. We would have expected a positive correlation, and we didn't see that. So the optimotor endpoint was not predicted by size of the fish. So in all, we found emerald shiners were able to see better under sedimentary turbidity than they were under algal turbidity. And we also found that there was really no relationship between fish length and visual abilities. So this is important because emerald shiners need to be able to forage, they need to be able to eat and mate, and to do all of this, they need to be able to see. And so with the recent Lake Erie algal blooms, it's really important from a management perspective to know the threshold of turbidity that an ecologically important species like the emerald shiner is no longer able to survive. So in the future, we found that standard length was not a good predictor of the vision of the fish. So we're going to take the fish home, and we're going to sex them. We're going to look at their eye size and the size of their optic lobe. And we're going to see if any of these are correlated with the ability of them to see with the endpoint. And then this is just a little photo of the difference in eye size. These are between species, but it happens within species as well. And I would like to thank Dr. Suzanne Gray, Chelsea helps me with everything, Chelsea Neiman, and the Ohio State University, Ohio Sea Grant, and Stone Laboratory and staff for RISE and just everything. Every single thing. My references.
So, chocolate milk, like water.
Yeah, actually, Chelsea's doing that in her experiment. It might be done with mine, but I did not have time over the 5 weeks to do that. But yeah, that would be really interesting, a blend.
Yeah. You were predicting at the beginning that the fish would be able to see better in the sediment than in the green algae. Was it because the algae had lower light transmission, or did it have anything to do with that wavelength shift?
It's more about the wavelength shift.
And how does that, what is their visual system like? Like, what are the
I don't know that much about the cones.
Are there reasons to think that they worse in the green because of the distribution of photoreceptors?
Well, Lydia will be our last speaker, and then our last speaker before our short break.
My pleasure to introduce Lydia Fai from Kalamazoo. She's been working on a crayfish project here around Putin Bay and South Bass Island. And she's doing this REU at Stone Lab, and then she'll be following up with 3 more weeks of research afterwards to complete her work on a senior, senior thesis, honor thesis? another class at Kalamazoo. So this is kind of the halfway point for Lydia. So take it away.
All right. So my name is Lydia Fai, and my supervisor is Roger Thoma, and we were looking at the distribution of the two crayfish species, Orchonectes russicus and Orchonectes propinquus, in the Putin Bay area of Lake Erie. All right, here are some background information. Orchonectes russicus, otherwise known as the rusty crayfish, is an invasive species native to the Ohio River Basin and has recently, as around the 1960s, started spreading into northern streams and lakes across the Great Lakes region and up into Canada. And it was probably brought to Lake Erie and all these northern watersheds via fishing bait because they would be brought in order to help with, to be a bait for fish, and then just kind of dumped and left. They are known to extirpate native crayfish species as well as disrupt invertebrate plant and native fish populations. They're also known to hybridize readily with propinquous and other native crayfish species. It has already been documented that they have actually displaced propinquous in northern Wisconsin watersheds. The other species our native species is Orchonectes propinquus, known as the northern clearwater crayfish. It's native to Great Lakes and to Canada. They're known to be intolerant to poor water quality, and their abundance and distribution has declined in Ohio as per recent times. So background on our particular study. We have previous collections by Dr. Ken Baker from Heidelberg University that found both russicus and propinquus around South Bass Island and other areas in Lake Erie. The propinquus specimens from the collection had this odd assortment of traits from both russicus and propinquus, so thus forth we will be referring to them as CF propinquus, showing that they appear to be propinquus, but they have some traits that causes us to cast some doubt on whether or not they're actually full-blown propinquous. So our goals of the study were to confirm the continued existence of these propinquous specimens from the collection, because as with any invasive species, they could be gone from this point, and that collection is about 10 years old at this point. And also to identify factors that may contribute to the fact that these species are still here in light of the invasive. So we were specifically looking at water chemistry and the depth. Our methodologies, like Alex, we had issues trying to get our study specimens. We tried using crayfish traps, but alas, we were not able to catch them despite using at least 5 different kinds of bait. So So eventually we gave up because we were catching mostly gobies, actually, in our trade. Lo and behold. So finally we decided we were going to snorkel around South Bass Island and Gibraltar Island to collect them by hand. We determined our sites that we were going to snorkel by looking at sites that are already in the previous collection and going to those sites and seeing if we could find the same specimens there, same species, and also the presence of a suitable habitat. So if the substrate was mostly sand, then there was likely not going to be any crayfish there, so we didn't want to waste our time, especially considering that we had to try and do all the snorkeling in like 3 weeks. So you would snorkel around looking for a rock, then you would dive down, flip the rock, and attempt to catch any crayfish that came out, which was incredibly difficult, but we did manage to catch some. And so here's a bucket full of crayfish that we got. And then we would record the location that we got them via a GPS unit. Water chemistry was taken with a YSI multi-parameter sonde to record temperature, pH, the dissolved oxygen, the percent saturation of our oxygen, turbidity, specific conductivity, and depth. Then we took the specimens back to the lab to identify them to species, including looking at the specific character traits that were in question, and then any kind of very basic numerical analysis was done in our studio. So first, let's look at our distribution. Here's a map of the propinquous specimens that we found around South Bass Island and Gibraltar Island. Up here is Buckeye Point. Around here would be, this is Gibraltar right here. And so we found them along the outskirts of it, but not within the actual Put-in Bay central area over here. Anyway, so here's our map of rusticus that we found around this same area. As you can see, they were all focused around Gibraltar Island and the Put-in Bay region. So they're all around. So let's look at them. If you look at them on the same map, you can very clearly see a definite kind of distribution and like segregation of the species. It doesn't seem to be as like there are any of these propinquous specimens where a rusticus is found. In fact, the rusticus were found in a very small area of our samples, larger sample scale. If you want to compare it to this past information from Ken Baker, and so when you overlay his data, which his propinquous are in blue, and his rusticus that we have recorded is this orange pentagon right there. That would be the alligator bar actually at that particular point, and you can see that our records of distribution are incredibly similar to his, showing that perhaps there hasn't been that much of a change in the distribution of rusticus, and they haven't really spread out farther in this area. So why? The answer is why. So we look at our water chemistry. Despite having very, very, very low sample sizes at this point, I ran a t-test to try and see if there were any kind of emerging patterns coming out, and actually the two stars shows a p-value that is about 0.05-ish, and then one star is the below 0.5. That would be for pH, dissolved oxygen, and specific conductivity. Now our sample sizes are small here, so we can't really say for certain whether or not this is actually leading to any kind of significant relationship, but because there seems to be an emerging pattern, we should keep an eye on those metrics as the sample size grows. Other than that, there actually didn't seem to be any difference in depth, which was against our previous hypotheses about what we would find. And then, looking into the interesting part, let's go to our character states. first one we look at is the rostrum of the crayfish. The Orchonectes propinquus has a diagnostic little carina, as in a little like ridge on its rostrum, as you can see here. This is one from a stream that was found in northern Ohio. So we're using this one as a comparison point to look at all our other propinquous specimens. This is a rusticus found in the Put-in Bay area. And these are all different propinquous that were found in the Put-in Bay area. Showing here, you can see that there's a pretty decent distribution of them. Not only do propinquous have a carina, but they also, the ridges on them are actually straighter than in a rusticus, which curve in a little bit. So you can clearly see a carina here on these two. You can kind of see it here, but it's less apparent over in this one. But the edges of it are straight like this one. So this variability in these traits leads you to think that maybe there's something really odd going on, and maybe we're having some kind of hybridization. So then move on to the next trait, are the mandibles. In a rusticus, they have this kind of first blade-like looking thing that then goes down into the smaller teeth, where in a propinquous, it's all jagged teeth all the way down. So when you look at our propinquous specimens here, you can see that their first teeth here almost will tend to have this kind of, almost like they're trying to be this blade, but they're not quite making it. And the specific shape that this takes is incredibly variable. And it's this particular character trait that really leads us to think that there might be some hybridization going on, just because it's so variable and there doesn't seem to really be a set standardization for them. And they're really not that terribly similar particularly these ones over here, which are very, very much close to a rusticus. So in conclusion, the distribution of rusticus appears to be limited to the Put-in Bay area and around Gibraltar Island, and does not seem to have spread out into the greater watershed area. However, there is some evidence that there might be hybridization between rusticus and propinquous populations. This means that we might not actually have propinquous here. Instead, we have something else entirely. The character traits on our propinquous show evidence of having rusticus traits. There does not appear to be a difference in the habitat with the depth and water chemistry metrics, although the exceptions may be pH, dissolved oxygen, and specific conductivity. However, because of our small sample size, we cannot say for certain whether those are true. Our further discussion that we have is perhaps this could be due to wave energy and the action, because in this specific area where we found the rusticus, the waves don't necessarily hit as hard. And so maybe the rusticus are just not as tolerant of extreme water movement. This is also interesting. We found the propinquous species out by the Miller Ferry Dock, which is somewhere that gets a lot of wave action. Another idea is perhaps we're dealing with a kind of secondary invasion that back in maybe even glacial times, rusticus species was able to move up here, but hybridization occurred, and so the propinquous that was in Lake Erie prior to the fish bait invasion were actually the result of that first invasion. Another idea is that the rusticus population is currently being limited by some other things, including predator avoidance behaviors. For this point, we bring up a sample point that we had at Oak Point, where every rock that we overturned had a big brown goby underneath it, and there was not a single crayfish to be found. Future directions, we will want to do further sampling in deep waters. We were not able to get those with snorkeling. So the people who are actually scuba certified could go down and try and get some for us. And then going to other islands around Lake Erie, particularly Kelly's Island, which has some similar cove-like geography. Some behavioral studies using laboratory experiments to look between these two populations, particularly substrate preference and any kind of aggressive behavior between the species. Is rusticus actually going to force out the propinquous, or is it just a matter that they're not getting to the propinquous in the first place? And then also to do some genetic analysis of our propinquous species. We've already taken tissue samples from them and are planning to send them off to another lab. Of course, these results will not be in until probably next spring, but this could shed some light on our particular on our hybrid hypothesis. I want to acknowledge the Stone Lab and the Sea Grant for giving me the opportunity to do this. Also, the Kalamazoo College Biology Department for being incredibly supportive. All who helped with the crayfish collection, particularly Dr. Darren Beatty for coming in at when we went to Peach Point and collecting some when we couldn't catch any. My family and friends for listening to me complain about the project. And then Roger Toma for being a great mentor and helping to problem solve through all of our setbacks that we had, which were many. All right, questions? Yeah?
I have a different possible explanation.
Yeah?
I'd like to propose it, and then you tell me if it's likely or not.
Oh, no, go ahead.
So I'm just not sure that you need that there needs to be some effective wave action or water chemistry, anything. What if most fishing happens in the Put and Bay portion of Belfast Island, and every summer 100 rusticus crayfish are dumped in there and just nowhere else around the island, and maybe they're more aggressive in displacing the propinquous, maybe not, but they're there, right? But the reason that they're not spreading is just because Lake Erie's so big, you've got so much propinquous like surrounding the island that the genetic introgression that would be happening from crossbreeding between the two species is just washed out by so many propinquous surrounding the island.
I think the comeback that I would have to that is that rusticus has been incredibly effective at spreading through stream systems, and it does this even from very tiny points of invasion. So the question is, why hasn't this happened in a span of at least 10 years? That looks a little odd. It could be something just because of that fishing's only happening in that particular area. But when you consider how rusticus behaves in areas outside of the lake, it makes you want to wonder what exactly is going on.
Could be that there are poor competitors in the lake environment.
Yeah.
The Ohio River.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, kind of along with that, I think there is something interesting going on here because you look like you are seeing hybrids outside of this immediate area. Why aren't you seeing them? There has to be something going on because if they're hybrid offspring right now,
yeah, I was thinking about the project, and it's like we were trying to unravel the knot, but instead we just brushed aside some dirt and found ourselves an even bigger knot that we now have to deal with. So, yes.
So one of the things that you measured the environmental parameters, oxygen, and pH, are probably mostly being driven by the macrophytes. So kind of related to that. Even in some of the Midwestern states, rusty crayfish are actually also introduced as macrophyte control in ponds. And so I'm wondering if the macrophyte habitat of the bay might be around the island, might be the reason for us to be there. I don't know about the macrophyte habitat in those other locations, but I think that's probably not. Is it just the habitat that's just different here? Is the macrophyte driving it?
That's also a possibility.
And Kelly's Island will have some light.
Other macrophytes there.
Yeah, some of those areas are pretty good.
Yes?
So, in invasive species, there's a theory of hybrid vigor where the invasive can breed with a native better at surviving or better at spreading to new locations. Do you know of any other studies where the rusty crayfish is hybridized?
Yeah, actually, there's at least one other where they did dynamics within a hybrid zone for the rusty crayfish, so it is documented that they will hybrid and that these hybrids are not inferior in any way.
So let's take about a 10-minute break, but before we do that, Roger would like to give the annual Stone Lab Mag Collector Award.
Stone Lab has a tradition instituted by Dr. Michael Hogarth for field zoology, where we go out for 5 weeks and we catch everything we can and we put it in a jar. It's really a ruthless operation. So we're all rather ruthless, but this is a special award for that individual that is the most ruthless individual. And just to give you a slight hint, Doug Kane was once the most ruthless student. Matt, I believe, was the progenitor of this whole problem. And tradition. He was so ruthless that something had to be done, and thus the Mad Collector Award was created. So, yeah, this year you get a star. Yeah. And your name on a plaque. The Mad Collector's name goes on a plaque. And it hangs in an office somewhere.
Actually, right behind you, and it's usually
here it is. And this year's Mad Collector will be going right here. We have room for 2017 and 18, and then we will have to enlarge the plaque yet again. So, and that will be hanging in the lab, and this gets to go home with the Mad Collector. Now, I had two Mad Collectors that were really mad. It was very close. And the break point between the two Mad Collectors had to come down to emotional approach. The one that was truly the most expressive of their joy of collecting things and putting them in jars and happy stuff like that was Lydia Bye. Lydia expressed a great deal of satisfaction about catching things, and she also, the mad part, when she missed something, she really got mad. She was mad on two scales here. So, here you are, Lydia. Congratulations.
Can you guys face this direction so we can get a
phone?
Here we are. There we go. Two mad collectors. Sorry, Brittany. You were so close. Well, Brittany has two small children, so she's learned to contain her emotions. She's seasoned, you know.
Justin, do you have times up there? You want to adjust slightly? What do you want to get?
Start back at 7:40. So these.
Okay, so from this graph you can see that there is a positive linear relationship between the two. So as you have more phosphorus loading, you also get an increase in cyanobacterial biomass. And these are some pictures we took. This was actually one of the only sampling days we have where we had some really kind of high levels of cyanobacteria. So this one's from the Sandusky subbasin. All of these dots that kind of look white, they're actually green. Those are microcystis, and this is from Sandusky Bay. You can just see how green the water is there. So this is really important because depending on how you measure the CHEP, you can actually come up with different concentrations. And if you're trying to treat water, it can make it really difficult if you don't actually know what the concentration is because there's variations between measurements. So for this project, we wanted to look at, because the buoys measure at such a low, they're a high depth, and the intakes are much lower, you may or may not actually be detecting the appropriate concentration to be able to treat the water. So there are lots of buoys that are being used right now to collect data, but the two we're focusing on is one in the Sandusky subbasin and one actually right outside, really close to this island. And these stream data continuously to the internet. They take things like temperature, total chlorophyll, they do blue-green algae through measuring phycocyanin and turbidity, but they only measure at 0.7 meters. So the big problem with these is that microcystis has these little gas vacuoles in it, so if you don't have any mixing, it'll actually float to the surface. So when you have wind speeds, like over here, less than 10 miles per hour, you get the microcystis coming to the top, so there's actually a lower concentration at the intake, but you're measuring higher, so you may be wasting a bunch of time and energy and resources treating water that you don't actually need to. But then if you have planktophytes and you have low mixing, it may actually sink to the bottom. So you're getting a higher concentration at the intake than the buoy is. Okay, so like I said, there's lots of buoys. They go from all the way over here to over by Cleveland, but we are only looked at two for this study. And this is the one that's right outside the window, and then this is the one in Sandusky. So this is the sampling we did. I took water samples at the surface and then down to 5 meters at every meter. And we put them in these little bottles and then we took them back and ran them in the floor probe. Right here. The floor probe is this little thing, and basically you take the water sample, you put it into this little glass cube, and you stick it in the machine, and it'll give you readings for concentrations of blue-green algae, total chlorophyll, diatoms, and all kinds of things. And then we also used, at the same time as we were getting water samples, a sond over here, which is the thing we had problems with getting the data off of. So theoretically, you put it in the water, you lower it to different depths, and it takes readings when you can get it, plug it into the computer, and have all the data, which doesn't always happen. So to compare the data, we used a lot of linear regression. So we compared the sond and the floor probe data for all dates, the individual dates and at both locations individually, and then we graphed the sond data and the buoy data to compare those for all the dates at Gibraltar, Sandusky, and both of those together, and then we compared the floor probe to the buoy as well for all the dates at Gibraltar, Sandusky, and both of the locations. So this is the first graph we have, which is Gibraltar blue-green algae for all the dates, and technically since the p-value is 0.03, this is a significant relationship, but the standard error is so high compared to the data range that you can tell they're all quite close to zero and really spread out. You can't really tell much from this because we never really got any concentrations to work with. However, in Sandusky, we did end up with some actual concentrations. So you see here the standard error is quite low compared, because the range in this one is 0 to 14 rather than less than 1. And then this tells you, based on the equation from the trend line, that if you have the sond data down here, you can predict the floor probe data in micrograms per liter by using this equation. So the next thing we did is we graphed the buoy readings compared to the sond or the floor probe. For this one in particular, we used the sond. And this is BGA and RFUs down here, and then depth over there. So for this one, you can see that buoy is slightly overestimating, but the concentration is pretty constant all the way down the water column. And then for this is on the 11th when we had much higher concentrations, and you can see that the concentration here kind of peaks at like 1,
and then decreases with depth. So in that case, you should theoretically be getting a reading that's really close to the buoy, but the buoy, for some reason, is underestimating. And this is one of the few ones we had where the buoy was actually quite spot on because it pretty much matched the curve. This one is for a total core, so rather than buoy. And then this BGA one as well was actually quite close to all of the SWAN data, but they're also really close to zero. So to compare all of these, we took this equation up here. We basically took the measurement from the buoys minus the measurement from the sond, and we divided it by the entire data range and then times it by 100 to get a percentage. And if it was greater than 20% in one direction or the other, we considered it as over or underestimating, but if it was within 20%, we considered it as being close. So it was really interesting for these because for some reason you're more likely have the buoy be considered as underestimating when you compare it with the floor probe, but it's more likely to be considered overestimating when you compare it to the sond. And here's the overall comparison. You can tell the sond has 14 that were overestimations, and the floor probe only had 3, as to where the floor probe had 17 for underestimations and 8 for the sond. So you can make two big conclusions from this. One is you can compare it to previous year's data to kind of see how the lake's doing. And then you can also really see that we need new technology to be able to monitor and detect these things more accurately. So this is last year on about July 24th, right outside there in Put-in Bay. And as you can see, if you came in today, the water doesn't quite look like that this year. That was pretty big bloom, very green. And this is just a graphical representation of that. So over here in July, like towards the end of July, you can tell that the concentrations are like over 10, as to where over here, the last time we sampled, they're less than 1. This is the same thing for Sandusky. These concentrations have been higher than Gibraltar all season so far, but you can kind of tell where it starts to peak, like late July, early August, and then the same thing over here, which we haven't quite got to see yet because it's very early. So I'm staying for 3 more weeks, so hopefully I can see something happen. So one of the solutions is to start using newer technology. One of the things with the YSI vertical profiler, it actually moves up and down and monitors the entire water column rather than just at the surface. So then you have information as to what's going on at the surface like we do now, but also something closer to the intake. Okay. And I'd like to thank Erica and Kristen and Justin for being so wonderful and helpful over this project. And then Captain Craig for taking some cool pictures and floating us around. And then friends film them.
We have time for a couple questions.
Were you able to, on the days where it was over underestimating, were you ever able to look at the wind speeds? Because as you indicated, less than 10 or greater than 10. So can you actually, is there any way to be able to adjust what the buoy is telling you in real time based on wind speed and wind direction to maybe get a better estimate since we don't have the technology that you referenced in the slide?
We have the wind speed, I think, and like the temperature from that day, but we didn't look at them.
But were there depth differences between the buoy located here and in Sandusky Bay? I know you were only measuring down to 5, but again, with the wind speed, perhaps the mixing in a shallower region rather than a deep region would affect that too.
I think because they're very similar buoys, but they measure at the same depth.
Yeah.
But if you looked within a particular day, not really.
Right, we did do that.
So which one's on the X and the Y, but I remember that on a particular day there was a lot of range in the X value, very little range in the Y value.
For one of these or
for that one.
Yeah. Yeah, we have all the depths for every day.
On July 11th, we've got a lot of difference horizontally on that. For all the other dates, they're kind of clustered about them. So what drives that?
Right now, I do have graphs for all the deaths for each individual day, so I would be able to look at it if I was turned back and saw those. Yeah, I know in some cases we did see that the surface concentrations were higher and it decreased when we went down, but there were a couple instances as well where it went the opposite way and actually increased the death.
Yeah, that's
we do have ones that are in the opposite direction. There's like a ton of graphs. I think it's like four graphs for every day.
So if you're advising a project and someone had to go out and sample, what method would you suggest they use? Because it seems like some are overestimating and some are underestimating.
Honestly, I couldn't really tell you because all of them are quite different. So. Sure.
Did you take replicates at any of these sites? Like, is it just a...
It's the same thing every day, but we only have one sample from each desk. So
I just think it's intriguing.
It could be a lot of things.
Yeah.
It really is. I was really confused when I saw the, like, on floor probe and the over and under estimations. I'm like, this makes no sense to me. Because especially for Gibraltar and for early Sandusky, we have a data range that's so small. So if it's off by a little bit, it's still such a high percentage of the entire range.
If you look at look at how much, if you look at that one graph, how high it can get, and that wasn't even as high as it could get, you know?
Yeah.
We need that other end of the side, and that's what was the problem last year. We just hit that.
It literally just started on our last sampling day, the 11th. What the pictures are from was the first day we saw, like, anything, really.
Like, we need a... You didn't hear me say that.
Yeah. Bad for the lake, just for the project.
All right, next up is Jennifer Brown. Jennifer comes to us from Indiana University, where she'll be a senior this fall, and she is majoring in environmental science and management. She's originally from near Chicago, so I guess she used to be kind of close to another Great Lake, so here she is on Lake Erie, and she's going to present some work for you on Lake Erie.
Hello, as Dr. Beatty says, my name is Jennifer, and I'm going to be a senior at Indiana University. And this summer, I got to work with Dr. Darren Beatty on an experiment titled Recycling of Nutrients from Sediment Resuspension in Lake Erie. And before I get into my research question, I'm just going to provide a short intro on eutrophication, because it's a big problem, especially in Lake Erie. Increasing eutrophication is especially apparent in Lake Erie during the summer when we see toxic algae bloom. And many people... Well, not many people. You mainly think that the increasing eutrophication in plants is due to external sources from agriculture, runoff, industrial discharge. But not all the time you think about the internal sources, the resuspension of the sediments and how much nutrients are released from that. So that's what resuspension of sediments is, the nutrients released from the sediment into the water. And that's what I'm looking at. And resuspension occurs during storms. And this year we didn't see a major storm per se, but we did see a few windstorms here and there. So, and here's a quote from Matsoff in his 2016 publication, and I think it sums up why I'm doing this research, is that we don't quite know how much nutrients are coming off of internal recycling in the water. And then this is just a picture of the basic, like, white camps you would see out in Lake Erie. My research question is,
how much influence does storm-driven resuspension of sediments have on the nutrients released in the water? And the second question I'm posing is, how do these nutrients impact the algae blooms and other organisms, other phytoplankton in Lake Erie? And that question I'm not going to answer, but if I would continue the research, that's ultimately the goal we'd want to know. So these are the sites I went to. I went on a boat, 2 days on a boat, and I went to 3 sites for each day. The first site, right off here, is right off of Cedar Point. Morgan sampled there plenty of times, off the buoy. The second site I went to was SEB. That site is in Sandusky Bay. And then I went farther east of Cedar Point, the site SW. The second day I went out to the boat, I resampled the buoy site again. So that's the same site. I just call it Buoy 2 instead. I went to Kelly's Island, which I know a lot of you visited right off there. And then my last site is Stone Labs Buoy, the one you see when you eat in the dining hall. So at each site, I collected sediment and surface water. I used an Ekman dredge to take the sediment, and I was concerned of just the top layer, the fluid-like layer on top, because that's ultimately what gets resuspended in the water. And then I used a Van Dorn sampler to collect the water at 1 meter deep. And this happens for each site. And once the samples were collected, I went back to the lab and immediately filtered the water, and this was to rid the water of any algae present in it. And then for each site, I took 11 bottles, save the control, the one right up there, and increase the amount of sediment in each bottle. So the first bottle got 1 drop of sediment, the second bottle got 2 drops of sediment, up to the 10th bottle that got 10 drops of sediment. And once I completed that, I had help wrapping them in tin foil, and this was to prevent any primary production, and then let them incubate out in the dock for 48 hours. This was to allow the sediment in the water to mix, make sure the samples didn't get too hot, and kept it out there for 2 days. So after the incubation, 48-hour incubation was over, I went back to the lab and started filtering the water. But I initially weighed the mass of the filters first, because once I filter it, then the sediment would get on the filters, and that ultimately would be my total suspended solid, is the sediment found right here, after combustion. Then I weighed them again and got the final mass. The filtrate I put through the auto analyzer, and we got dissolved concentrations of nitrate, nitrite, ammonia, phosphate, and silica. So this is my first result, and there's a lot on this graph, but I wanted to graph all the sites at once. So on the bottom we have total suspended solids, and on the y-axis, we have nitrate concentration. And the first thing you probably would notice is that there's a strong linear relationship at all sites. As total suspended solids increases, the amount of nitrate increases as well. As you see inside SEB, it has the lowest concentration, while the buoy sites up there have some of the highest concentrations. But what I really want you to take away from this graph is the slope. Disregard Kelly's site, but look at these slopes. They're very similar. They're between 0.002 and 0.005. So what this tells me is that the amount of nitrate being released at each site is very consistent. Whatever is releasing the nitrate is consistent at each site. So if we move on to phosphate, once again, there's a lot of data here. I plotted all the sites, and we are told to suspended solids on the x-axis and phosphate concentration on the y. And we do see a relationship of increasing TSS and increasing phosphate, but we don't see the same variability that we did in the nitrate. The slope values are a little more spread out, so there's more variability among how much phosphate is released at each site. And I'll come back to this graph, but right now. And then a quick note on ammonia. Ammonia levels were undetectable, and this will be important for my next slide. I'll explain that. So as I was conducting the experiment, we started to ask the question, is the nutrients we're measuring the actual nutrients that's being resuspended,
or is it the nutrients that's embedded in the water already? So what I did is I went back to the buoy and SEB site and collected sediment samples. And I filtered the sediment samples right away. And we got like this much water out of it, and we immediately put it through the autoanalyzer. And here are my results in the sediment. So if we look at phosphate, the sediment, the filtered sediment water showed pretty high amounts of phosphate. And then once resuspension occurs, that's the water column, it contributes to the same, pretty much the same amount of phosphate is contributed into the water. If you look at ammonia, you see there's a lot of ammonia concentration in the sediment pore water, as by this column. But then once it gets resuspended, the ammonia concentration is extremely low. And then in contrast, if you ignore the SCB data and just look at the buoy data right now, the sediment concentration in the water, in the pore water, is very low. But once it's resuspended, it's extremely high. And I said to ignore the SCB because SCB had low nitrate concentrations to begin with. So we based off of, made a hypothesis, kind of conclusion, that ammonia is quickly nitrified in the water. That's why you see high amounts of ammonia in the sediment, but not in the water once resuspension occurs, and the opposite effect for nitrate. So based on the TSS and nutrient data that I showed you, we can use turbidity, which is the amount of particles, a measurement of particles in the water, the cloudiness of the water, turbidity data to estimate how much nutrients are released based on the increase of turbidity. So what I did was took turbidity data from the sun and TSS data from the lab and made a relationship, as seen right here, and this is the equation that I created. And based off this equation, we'll now look at the turbidity data that I find relevant. So I'm going to look at just this box because this is the time we were here at Stone Lab. And this day specifically is July 1st because you remember that's when there was a little windstorm throughout the day and you saw a little white cap in the Lake Erie. And but you only saw about a 7 increase in NTU, but I'm still going to use it. So increasing the 7 NTU, we can plug it back into this equation to get to total suspended solid. And then once we have that value, we can make a high estimate and a low estimate. And the estimates are based off the slopes of each site. So I chose the site with the highest slope and the site with the lowest slope to get a range. So after plugging that values in, we get an estimated nutrient value of 0.01 and then 0.0029. So what does this mean? It means, if you look at the next chart, we see this is a graph of the amount of phosphate recorded from the lab throughout the month. And I was specifically looking at here, and we don't have data. I don't have data here on how much phosphate was in the water at that time. But based on the application that I just talked about, we can predict the phosphate in the water at that time would increase to 0.01 to 0.029. And that's what this is showing right here. And if you take any conclusions from this, that's not a big increase in nutrient concentration. It's very small. So we did the same thing for nitrate. We took a high estimate and then I took a low estimate and graphed it again, this time using nitrate collected from the lab, nitrate concentration, over a period of time. And once again, we don't have data for the 7.1 that I looked at specifically, but if the turbidity increased in 7 NTU, we would see like a 0.06 to 0.138 increase too, which is a very small amount of nutrient increase. So if you take any conclusions based on this, is that the typical common windstorm in Lake Erie, like ones you might see in the summer, they don't appear to release as much nutrients. The resuspension of nutrients is very low, almost at undetectable levels. I took two minor conclusions from this. I'm just going to restate again is that the amount of nitrate released from the sediments is pretty consistent at each site. And there's high amounts of ammonia
in the sediment, but not necessarily once it's suspended. So I'm going to end it with a question. Well, what if we saw a major storm? And if you guys were here last year, there was bigger storms than what we've seen this year in terms of like windstorms and that. And based on REU data and a presentation, they found that with a turbidity increase of about 53 MTU, we would see a slight increase in phosphate, about a range of about 0.1. So once again, even a big windstorm or major storm, whatever happened last year, the amount of nutrients we suspended is still very low. So with that, I would like to thank all those who've helped me, major and minor, and I'm open for questions.
There's time for a question or two. Mm-hmm.
So the ammonia in the water, I thought you said it was below detection level.
Oh, it did. And then?
Where you got, then you had values.
Right here?
So, yeah, that.
Maybe I meant close detection. A lot of it was undetectable.
The ammonia in the water was detectable.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So when you looked at the two graphs, I saw the idea that all the slopes are identical except for Kelly's.
And
then when you went to the other one where the phosphate were all different slopes, but clearly the least dramatic slope within that one was also Kelly's.
Right.
So do you have any hypotheses on why Kelly's was so weird?
Oh, right. Because, well, if you took the last four data out from Kelly's, it would say the slopes are very similar. And Kelly's Island had a lot of sand, which means a lot of nutrients weren't going to be in the sediment to begin with. So.
And so with all the sediment coming down these tributaries, you took a sample of the sediment at the surface and then were able to get this prediction or this line. Would you have to re-go to the sediments every year to reset up that relationship, or do you think that's a relationship that will remain constant?
This relationship?
Yeah.
Well, the last REU person that had similar data, his relationship was slightly different. It was more 1-to-1, and mine's more 1-to-5. So around that ballpark, but yes, we probably would. It could change.
Thanks, Rick. And my second REU this year is Michael Albrecht. And he is also a senior, and he is from Clemson University. He lives in Columbia, South Carolina, but spends a lot of his time in the summer up here at Lakeside, so has some knowledge of the Great Lakes and Lake Erie from that time. And so he's also going to talk about a project on Lake Erie and the specific Gadusky Bay.
Okay. Yeah, I'm Michael, and my project is the cyanobacterial assemblage and its relationship to nitrogen cycling and microcystin concentrations in Sandusky Bay. There are several genera of cyanobacteria that are generally implicated in harmful algae blooms in Lake Erie. And some of these are capable of producing microcystin, which is a liver toxin and a skin irritant, also an eye and throat irritant. And in Sandusky Bay, Planktothrix is the dominant genus that is implicated in these blooms. And its biomass is usually high throughout the summer bloom. But microcystin concentrations vary widely over this time period. It's fairly obvious a lot of times to see, the water looks kind of scummy, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it's not safe for swimming at any given time. And nitrogen concentrations, like different species of nitrogen, have been implicated in to affect microcystin production. So some cyanobacteria are capable of fixing atmospheric nitrogen instead of using inorganic nitrogen. And when inorganic nitrogen concentrations in the water have been depleted, they start to do nitrogen fixing. And they grow specialized cells called heterocytes for this purpose. This is where the fixing goes on. So my questions are, how does the algal species composition and the nitrogen concentrations relate to toxin levels? And is microcystin tied to the uptake of a particular nitrogen species? And does nitrogen fixation lead to more toxin? See, if we have nitrogen fixation going on, then there's the potential that some of the like ammonium is going to leak out and it's going to feed other algae in the area, so it could increase algal biomass overall. So microcystin, well, one alternative hypothesis is that microcystin production is linked to plankton fixed biomass. But Davis and others already suggested this hypothesis may be incorrect. Or an alternative hypothesis is that microcystin production is linked to a specific mode of nitrogen acquisition by cyanobacteria, which would be controlled by a gene regulator that's also responsible for regulating the nitrogen uptake pathway. The water samples were collected from June to September of last year and were analyzed for microcystin toxin, ammonium, nitrate, and nitrogen fixation at different sites in Sandusky Bay, and algae samples were also collected but were not initially analyzed. So what I did was I looked at the algae makeup from this site with this, the flow cam, which is a device that's basically a camera attached to a microscope with like a water pumping system to move water past the lens. And it takes pictures of all the particles that go through, and it has some computer software that kind of like helps you separate them like by genus or whatever your specifications are. But it's not perfect, so I spent a lot of time manually, you know, sorting through things, making sure they're in the right place. And we counted Planktothrix, Cuspidothrix, and Dolichospermum, or the algae formerly known as Anabaena. So this is at site 1163, Planktothrix concentrations from about June to September, and microcystin concentrations, Planktothrix biomass. So really, there doesn't really seem to be a good relationship here. And this is probably because some strains of microcystin don't produce, some strains of Planktothrix don't produce microcystin at all. So this is obviously a kind of a visual aid that I made, but this is kind of to show what kind of trends that we've been seeing in a lot of our data. In the early summer, ammonium gets used up pretty quickly because it's the easiest energetically to use by algae. Then nitrate gets used. And then after that, we get a peak in microcystin. And then sometime after that, we have, well, after like nitrogen gets used up, after nitrate gets used up, we get nitrogen fixation. So here we have nitrate and ammonium over the summer. And we have peaks in June for both because of a lot of discharge from storm events. And ammonium gets used up quickly, and nitrate persists for a while. So then this is from all the data that was taken last year of sites in Sandusky Bay and in the sub-basin, comparing ammonium to microcystin. And whenever we have high ammonium, there's also low microcystin. So here we have ammonium and we have microcystin. And whenever we have high ammonium, we have low toxin. Whenever we have, and same here. And we think that this is because the cyanobacterial pathway for the uptake of ammonium does not lead to the production of microcystin. So here we have nitrate and we have toxin. And the, again, the peak toxin occurs when the ammonium was low at the beginning of July, and this is right after the nitrate goes down, or right during the time that the nitrate goes down. And we think this is due to the gene regulator that is involved in the nitrate uptake. So here we have microcystin again, and now we have nitrogen fixation, which takes off when microcystin is going away, like when nitrate is going away. This late season spike in microcystin may be due to some sort of nitrogen recycling, like organic forms that are in the water. We're not really sure about that. So this is a cuspidothrix with a heterocyte, and the biovolume that I found is really well correlated to the time period that nitrogen fixation was happening. This is dolichospermum, and again, it is also really well correlated to the nitrogen fixation. Okay, so in early summer, ammonium concentrations are used up by algae. Then they go for the nitrate. And after that's gone, they start to do nitrogen fixation. And this is tied to the growth of cuspidothrix and dolichospermum, which are capable of doing this. And planktothrix stays present throughout the summer, but only produces toxin when it is using nitrate. So this is kind of like four quadrants of like four different situations we can have. We can have high ammonium and nitrate, low ammonium, high nitrate, low both, or high nitrate and low nitrate and high ammonium. So typically at the beginning of the summer we have high nitrate and high ammonium, and they use the ammonium, no microcystin, and then that moves into low ammonium, high nitrate, they use nitrate and they produce microcystin. And then we go into low of both, and they either start doing nitrogen fixation, or they maybe try and recycle some forms of N that are already there from the breakdown of other algae. And they may produce microcystin here, but it kind of depends on what form they're using. So to conclude, the toxicity of blooms seems to be controlled by the species of nitrogen present. And understanding the role of nitrogen will allow us to better manage algae blooms in the future. And future research could expand and analyze species composition at other sites in the bay and other sites as in the lake at large. So many, many thanks to these people.
You mentioned decaying algae as another source of nitrogen. Did you run into any readings when you were doing literature about any other processes?
It could be something like stuff coming up from the sediment.
Another one that's been implicated for Sandusky Bay, glyphosate. It has both phosphorus, nitrogen, and it also has carbon. And some people in Tennessee are actually doing research, and they hypothesize that one of the reasons that a non-nitrogen fixer does so well in the bay throughout the whole April to November is other.
Might be outside the scope of your project, but so what is the source of the ammonia
It seems to be river discharge. Like some of the fertilizers, I think, get turned into ammonium by some processes that happen. I can't remember exactly.
Okay.
So up next is Brittany. Brittany comes to us from Cleveland State University. She has some prior experience at Stone Lab. She was in Doug's one-week class last summer, and she was also in the Algae ID course. So if you're interested in learning more about Algae ID, we offer a class, and Brittany loved it so much that she came back for a full month of research on identifying algae.
So, like Justin said, my name is Brittany Dalton, and my project looks at the role of nutrient limitation in the central basin cyanobacterial blooms. And this is especially important because we know a lot about the blooms that occur in the western basin and the nutrient dynamics that occur there, but we occasionally have these blooms that happen here in the central basin, and not a lot is done. Research has been done about the dynamics and why they're occurring here and what's going on. So this image here is actually from a small bloom that occurred about 2 weeks ago in the central basin. So looking at these central basin blooms, they've been attributed to a particular species of algae called Dolichoferma, as Michael talked about in his presentation. And they've been documented to happen in 2012, 2013, 2015, and then now the small bloom in 2016. And these blooms that happen in oligotrophic systems, you usually hear about them happening in eutrophic systems, have been poorly studied in general. And the central basin performs more like an oligotrophic system because it's relatively nitrogen-rich and phosphorus-poor. So it's kind of like an enigma why Dolichoferma is here, because also, like Michael talked about, it does have the capability to fix nitrogen. So it's usually found in phosphorus-rich systems that are nitrogen-poor. So this is an aerial image of the bloom that happened a couple weeks ago. Like I mentioned, it's off of Fairport Harbor here. And then this is actually an image of Dolichoferma without heterocysts, which I'm going to talk about in the next slide. And so some of the recent research that's been done on these central basin blooms show that even though it has the ability to produce toxins, it's not doing so in the central basin, or at least it hasn't been documented to do so. And also, Justin's kind of found in his previous research and through observations that when you find Dolichoferma in the central basin, that it's lacking in heterocysts, which means that it doesn't have the ability to fix atmospheric nitrogen. So we're not really sure what it's doing here. So in looking at the literature, there's three possible reasons or drivers for its presence here, and that could be contributing to limitations. So the first one's iron, and we know that it's essential for assimilation, and especially important in the absence of heterocysts, since it can't fix that atmospheric nitrogen. And also that cyanobacteria in general are competitive for iron in oligotrophic systems. So also, we know that molybdenum is important in assimilation also, and that boron is a trace nutrient that's required for the formation of heterocysts. So kind of the questions that we're asking are low concentrations of these trace nutrients creating like a nitrogen-limited situation and allowing Dolichoferma to be present in a system where it normally wouldn't be present. So three questions that we wanted to focus on with this research were to examine phytoplankton growth and biomass based on chlorophyll A concentrations. And kind of our hypothesis is that growth will be limited by low concentrations of phosphorus, nitrogen, and these trace nutrients that I talked about in the previous slide. And also to look at nitrate assimilation, and that we hypothesize that that will be limited by low iron concentrations, since that is required for assimilation. And then also to look at how the Dolichoferma is forming heterocysts in numbers too, and that we hypothesize that will be limited by low boron concentrations. So some of the methods that we used to test these hypotheses were we went out and sampled three times and ran three experiments, 40 liters of surface water from this offshore Avon site right here, the Central Basin. And that was on June 2nd, June 25th, and July 6th. And then we took some initial measurements and recordings, which I'll talk a little bit more about too. And we ran this experiment looking at these nutrient enrichment bioassay projects. So it's they're like bottle experiments where you add a limiting nutrient and you would expect
growth over control in the bottles that you add the limiting nutrients to. So we added them to 1 liter of lake water, and I had 9 treatments, and each treatment was ran in triplicate, so a total of 27 bottles. So I had the phosphorus or control, a phosphorus-only treatment, an ammonium-only treatment, phosphorus and ammonium together, phosphorus and iron, phosphorus and molybdenum, phosphorus and boron, a treatment that had everything added to it, and then phosphorus and nitrate. So then we took those 1 liter bottles and we incubated them here in this incubator and for 6 to 7 days in a light dark cycle that we set at 300 par, which is the light level that's like roughly about a half a meter below the surface of the lake. And they were set at the temperature of the time of sampling, which varied between experiments slightly. And then, so at the end of each experiment, when we would take it down, we would look at, we're looking at chlorophyll A, which is like a phytoplankton biomass measurement. And we measured it with the flora probe that Morgan talked about in her experiment. And then we also looked at nitrogen assimilation, measured with the autonutrient analyzer. And then we also are in the process of looking at heterocyst formation that we're looking at with the flow cam that Michael talked about. So I'm going to talk now about some of my chlorophyll A results. And as I said before, they're an indicator of phytoplankton biomass and overall like growth limitations. And that was this is a picture of the flora probe here that we used to measure that. And kind of just to orient everyone what's going on with this graph, the black bar and all these graphs will be like the initial concentrations that I talked about we measured. So we also took those for each one of those parameters with each one of those pieces of equipment. And then each gray bar is an average of each triplicate. So each, so this is like the control, an average of all three controls and all three phosphorus treatments. And then the letters you see here are two key pairwise comparisons that show you which means are most closely related. And then that was also ran with a one-way NOVA analysis. So this is my first chlorophyll A graph from the first experiment that we ran on June 2nd. And what you're seeing here is just a phosphorus, nitrogen, and iron co-limitation. So if you look at the bar here for phosphorus and ammonium added, and then phosphorus and iron added, and then the category was all added, their means are most similar. So we were seeing an overall co-limitation with those nutrients there. And then this is the second chlorophyll A data from the second experiment ran on June 25th. And this one here just shows an overall phosphorus limitation. So all the treatments that had phosphorus added to them were all pretty similar and all showed similar growth patterns. And this is my third experiment ran on July 6th looking at the chlorophyll A data. And this shows a pretty strong phosphorus and nitrogen co-limitation where the phosphorus and ammonium treatment showed growth over the others, and also the treatment with everything added to it there. So now I'm going to talk about some of my nitrate results, and this was measured with the auto nutrient analyzer here, and it also analyzes other nutrient parameters as well that we plan to look at in the future, but right now we're just focusing on the nitrate data. So you're looking at these overall concentrations as an indicator of nitrate assimilation. So throughout all three experiments, all of the data was very similar. So you would see higher nitrate assimilation with all phosphorus treatments, and then there was really no impact of iron in the experiment. So, and with the third experiment that we ran, the initial concentration was a little bit higher, but overall they were really similar. And then if you look here at this phosphorus and nitrate treatment, it's much higher than the rest because we were adding nitrate to that treatment, so it wasn't assimilating it as quickly as the others because it had a much higher concentration of nitrate added to it. So going back to the first chlorophyll A graph from the first experiment and the nitrate data, if you can see here, you see a phosphorus and iron spike in the treatment with the chlorophyll A. And then what I wanted to just mention is that we don't think that this is related or associated to nitrate assimilation because if you look at the nitrate data, the phosphorus and iron category and the phosphorus category are all very similar. So likely what's going on there, as opposed to being driven by a difference in nitrate assimilation, is that iron does play another important role in cell physiology than just assimilation. So it could be driven by photosynthesis or respiration or something else could be driving that process there. So. And as far as our heterocyst data, we're still looking at that. This is the flow cam here. I know Michael talked a little bit about it, but having 27 treatments to look at, and when you run a sample, it takes about 8,000 images each time. So if you can imagine like counting heterocysts on each one of those and then sorting it, takes some time. So coming back to our hypothesis and looking at whether or not they were supported, with the first hypothesis that growth will be limited by low concentrations of phosphorus, nitrogen, and trace nutrients. Phosphorus, nitrogen, and trace nutrients all constrain growth at some point in the experiment, so that hypothesis was supported. And then the hypothesis that nitrate assimilation would be limited by low iron concentrations, iron did not impact nitrate assimilation in any of the experiments, so that was not supported. And then for our heterocyst hypothesis, the data is still pending on that. We're looking at it. I think we've run 3 or 4 samples, and we still have quite a bit of it. So this is part of a 3-year research project, and just looking back at some of the data that's been collected over the past 3 years, similar to 2016 data, the phosphorus was the primary limiting nutrient in all 3 experiments. And then also in all 3 years, similar to this year, there was no impact of iron and nitrate assimilation. And looking at the differences in whether a bloom was present or not, in 2014 there was no bloom, so heterocyst data couldn't really be analyzed. And then in 2015, boron wasn't shown to increase heterocyst formation when there was a bloom present. And then that data is still pending for this year. And then there was some nitrogen co-limitation apparent in mid to late summer in 2014 and 2015, so it'll be interesting to see what goes on with that as we continue with this data this year. So here are the people I'd like to thank, all the people in the Water Quality Lab, Dr. Chaffin, Erica, Kristen, Kara, for helping me analyze all my data, and Emily, we work together in our projects, and Captain Craig, the Friends of Stone Lab, and all of the Stone Lab crew.
We have time for a few questions.
Could you go back to the slide with the nitrate assimilation results? Okay. So this is looking at the nitrate that I guess is remaining after the experiment.
Correct. Well, you have your initial that's before, and then all the gray bars would be after.
Was some additional uptake in some, but not really clear.
Sure. And then definitely no impact of the iron.
Well, I guess that would be the trick to calculate it, to know what was the actual initial concentration in the vial or in that experiment. So I understand you added nitrate to it.
In that particular treatment?
Right. And so some ways of trying to calculate not just what the final concentration is, but what the amount that was down over time.
Value. The black part is the initial.
Right, but not in the nitrate.
No, he's saying not in that particular treatment.
Oh, yeah.
That hard to tell what's going on. I know it's just that one.
So was nitrate added to the all?
No. That all is phosphorus, ammonium, iron, molybdenum, and boron. The only treatment that nitrate was added to is the nitrate phosphorus treatment. And I know, too, that to talk about how that statement that you made, I know what we're doing as we're filling the bottles is we're, like, I think every 2 or 3 samples we're inverting and shaking the 40-liter jug to kind of reduce some of that air, too.
When you showed the 3 different dates, what was driving or what was co-limiting in those scenarios varied in each of the dates.
Yeah.
So biologically, can you give us maybe an insight on what might be driving that?
My hypothesis on that is just that there's a seasonal variability of, so the floor probe is measuring chlorophyll A, but then it's also measuring like species composition of different algae. So this is just an average measurement of each one of those things. So. Actually, in the first 2 experiments, we had like non-detects for cyanobacteria, so they were really low. So there's, that's my theory, is that maybe it's like a seasonal thing where, you know, diatoms come in the spring. And then
it's a species count.
That's what I think.
Okay. Any other questions?
Final speaker is Emily. She comes to us from Ohio Northern University. When she's not running around the island, she was working in the water quality lab, working on a project with Sandusky Bay. And she also has some research experience with their glyphosate, correct? And she came here in eighth grade, and I forget what her cover letter initially said, but like she said, it was like a life-changing thing or whatever. She wanted to come back. And also, when you're writing a cover letter, a good thing to do is make it very specific to the person you want to work with. And Emily wrote my name in it. So, a good way to get someone's attention, employer, professor for grad school, put that person's name in there. And when they'll read it, they'll know, oh, this person actually wants to work with me, rather than just shotgun approach of sending the same cover letter to everybody. So, last speaker.
Thank you. So, as Justin said, my name is Emily, and my project was studying the effects of nitrogen form and light on plankton growth and toxicity in the Sandusky Bay. So why does this matter? As you've heard over and over again for the past hour, cyanobacteria can produce toxins. And the toxin of interest in our study was microcystin, which is a hepatotoxin or a liver toxin, as Michael explained to you. And this is a toxin that's produced by many cyanobacteria, such as planktothrix here, and also microcystis. This is a map of the Sandusky Bay. And over here we have the western basin, which you typically will see microcystis dominance in. And then in the eastern basin, it's usually more dominated by planktothrix. So our site was over here, kind of in the middle of the eastern basin. So the main species that we looked at was planktothrix. And previous research in this area has indicated that nitrogen form has an impact on growth and toxicity. So research by Davis showed that bloom growth and microcystin concentrations responded more frequently to additions of nitrogen than they did to additions of phosphate. And then we also, on the other hand, have previous research that shows the impact of light intensity and how this affects growth and toxicity. So Salvador found that growth rates were higher at 30 micromoles of light, and that microcystin concentrations per cell were higher at 4 micromoles of light. An interesting thing just to note about this is that Salvador used light intensities much lower than the light intensities we used. So his high light treatment was at 30 micromoles of light, while that was our medium light treatment, or light intensity. And our high light intensity was actually 300 micromoles, which, as Brittany explained, is about the amount of light half a meter below the surface of the lake. And the reason we wanted to look there was because when the lake mixes, the planktothrix is kind of propelled up towards the surface. So we kind of wanted to see how they're responding to a new location close to the surface and a higher light intensity. So while we have research that shows the impact of nitrogen form, and then separately we have research that shows the impact of light, there's nothing out there that shows the interaction between nitrogen form and light together. So my project wanted to look at this interaction and see how it's impacting growth and toxicity. So in order to do this, we used integrated water samples that we collected from the Sandusky Bay, and we brought them back to the lab and performed a nutrient enrichment bioassay, which, as Brittany explained, is just adding different nutrients to the samples, and we did this in triplicate. Our treatments were a control, which had no nutrients in it. And then we had a phosphorus-only treatment, a phosphorus plus nitrate treatment, a phosphorus plus ammonium treatment, and a phosphorus plus urea nitrogen treatment. So the three forms of nitrogen that we looked at were nitrate, ammonium, and urea. And then we incubated these samples at three different light levels, so 3, 30, and 300 micromoles of light, and this is photosynthetically active radiation, or FAR. And if you remember the picture that Brittany had in her slide, she kind of showed the setup of the incubation. So the samples closest to the top of the incubator were exposed to the most light, and then the ones below that were exposed to lower light, and so forth. And then I explained how much light is in 300 micromoles, or how much light 300 micromoles is. But if you were trying to think about how much light 3 micromoles were, you might think about the amount of light present in this room. But down here you can kind of see my samples after we remove them from the incubator after 48 hours. And from left to right we have high light, medium light, and low light. And they are ordered in the same order that I listed up here in terms of nutrients. And you can already kind of make some qualitative observations here. So here these ones are a lot greener, indicating an increase in chlorophyll A. After we took down the experiment, we had to measure the growth and toxicity. So in order to measure the growth, we looked at chlorophyll A concentrations with the fluoroprobe. And one thing about chlorophyll A concentrations is that while it was okay for Brittany to use in her experiment because she was just using one light level, when you use different variables like I did, sometimes it doesn't always indicate growth as accurately. So in order to verify these results, we used the flow cam that Michael talked about. And we manually sorted through the planktothrix and then used those to quantify the biomass. And then to measure toxicity, we use an enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, or ELISA. And so these results show the total chlorophyll A concentrations at high light. Just to orient you, here is the initial concentration at about 75 micrograms per liter. And then when we look at the control and the phosphorus, we have about 25 micrograms per liter. And then we see a pretty big jump after you add nitrogen up to about 100 micrograms per liter. This tells us that adding nitrogen at high light increases the amount of total chlorophyll A. And then when we look ahead to the rest of the light levels, you see a similar trend. So adding nitrogen is increasing the amount of total chlorophyll A in the samples. And we verified these with a two-way ANOVA test and found that the nutrient addition did have a significant impact. And however, we didn't see that there was a significant difference among nitrogen forms. So as you can see, the red bars are pretty even, not much of a difference all the way across. Same story with the green bars and also the blue bars. The nitrogen form didn't seem to have a very significant impact on total chlorophyll A concentration. And what this tells us is that planktothrix is going to utilize nitrate, ammonium, or urea when they're under nitrogen limitation. So it doesn't really matter what form it is. They're going to use it anyway. And then we also found that light has significant impact. You can see here, medium light significantly stimulated the total chlorophyll A concentration. However, when we look at the biovolume data, we have a different result. Here, you see that the highest biovolume was at high light as opposed to medium light here. So here, we're actually seeing light-limited growth at 30 PAR. So while this is different, we did see a consistency in the fact that nutrients were increasing the amount of total chlorophyll A concentration. So nitrogen form again, or nitrogen addition again, increased the amount of biovolume or growth. So why were the chlorophyll A results and the biovolume results different? Well, in order to kind of look at this, we plotted the two variables against each other. And you can see here that the highest biovolume was occurring at the highest light level, and that the highest total chlorophyll A concentrations were occurring at medium light level, indicated by the red here. So the reason why there was such a disparity here is because chlorophyll A is not really a good representation of biomass when you're using different light levels. This is because photosynthesis, obviously, is driven by light. And when you're exposed to different levels of light, the cells have these photosystems that are going to respond differently and making different concentrations of chlorophyll A. So while the amount of chlorophyll A per cell is increasing, this isn't necessarily indicative of the total amount of growth that's occurring. So when we're looking at growth, we're going to want to use the biovolume results as opposed to the chlorophyll A results. And another thing I just wanted to point out is this kind of outlier of a data point here. If you look at this kind of trend, this one seems to be a little bit off. We're not exactly sure why that is, but it's possible that maybe urea is producing chlorophyll A and it's producing microcystin, which we'll see later, but it's just not growing. So that's something that we could look into further in the future. And then when we look at our toxicity results, we see that toxicity increased only upon nitrogen addition here. So the only significant p-value we had for the for this data was under nutrient addition. And we see that the initial concentration as well as the control and the phosphorus are about or below 10. And then when you add nitrogen, these levels exceed 10 and go as high as 15. So this is telling us that when you add nitrogen, it's increasing toxicity. However, there didn't seem to be much of a significance with nitrogen form. So when we vary nitrogen form, we weren't really seeing a difference in toxicity. Also, when we looked at light, that didn't seem to have much of an impact either. So the major conclusions that you can gather from my research are that if you add nitrogen of any form, you're going to see an increase in total chlorophyll A, you're going to see an increase in planktopic biomass, and you're going to see an increase in toxicity, which implies nitrogen limitation. Also, we didn't see any significant differences among nitrogen forms. So when planktopic is nitrogen starved, they're going to use nitrate, they're going to use ammonium, or they're going to use urea. Light didn't seem to have a significant impact on microcystin production. However, it did seem to stimulate growth. So the highest biomass occurred at the highest light level. So this suggests that there was some light-limited growth occurring in the planktopic. And we also saw that chlorophyll A is not a good indicator of biomass when you're comparing multiple light levels. So in the future, we plan to rerun the same experiment, except instead of using planktopics from the Sandusky Bay, we're going to instead look at the microcystis in the Maumee Bay. Another thing we're going to kind of look at is light stress at our high light, because we saw so much growth under the high light, which is typically unusual with planktopics because they're usually in lower light. So it's possible that significant stimulation and growth was occurring as a response to light stress, so that's something we can look into a little more. And then we're also still waiting on RNA transcription results that are going to tell us a little bit more about the toxin-producing genes in planktopics and ultimately contribute to our toxicity data. So with that, I would just like to acknowledge all the individuals and groups that helped make my research possible. And thank you all for listening, and open it up to questions.
I think you're definitely seeing a proto inhibition there for planktothrix. If you come across any gradients curves for that genus that would tell you what other people found?
I haven't, not yet.
One thing I'd suggest is look at Joe Conroy's dissertation, which was done at Sandusky Bay, and he did different light levels.
Yes, so the incubator was controlling several variables, including night and day. So it was set to a diurnal cycle, so you could mimic night and day. And then it was also set to the temperature of the lake.
Even though you had high light up here?
Yeah, the temperature, yes, sorry, the temperature was consistent, yes.
So your results are somewhat contradictory to what?
Yeah, I noticed that.
So the one thing, so... His research is really environmental conditions and what we saw in the environment, very specifically experimental. And the one thing in reading a lot of these papers, the experimental approaches that I've read, has been really frustrating to try to reconcile some of the findings we have with the experimental data, is that it fails to sometimes tell you what were the environmental conditions that they took the water sample. So, for instance, would you happen to know what the nitrogen concentrations were of the sample?
I think we took original nutrient data, yes.
No, that the nitrate was below the temperature.
Anyone,